Cooper Webb, and I choose OGIO.
I'm Christian Craig.
I'm Dean Wilson.
I'm Aaron Plessinger.
I'm Darren Martin.
I'm Nate Thrasher.
I'm Shane McElrath.
I'm Hunter Lawrence.
My name's Jet Lawrence.
I'm Jordan Smith.
I'm Talon Hawkins.
Stargate Hampshire.
I'm Hayden Deegan.
I'm Colt Nichols. And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
I'm Tom Biala. I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
I'm Jiren Ferrangis. And I choose OGIO.
All new Yamaha YZ450F. Narrower, more compact, and lighter. Built to do one thing, go faster.
Hey everyone, welcome to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. I'm Donn Maeda. I'm joined today by Justin Bogle. I was thinking about it. I was kind of Googling some stuff to get the dates right. Man, dating myself and you a little bit, we've been friends for like well over a decade, probably 15 years.
I'm getting old. Yeah. I am. No offense to you, because you're definitely older.
I'm definitely old.
Yeah, man. Hey, I got a couple gray hairs. Popping up, it's getting a little salty up there, so, you know, wear like a badge of honor, though, you know what I mean? I mean, with doing a career like this, you just never know, so I'm happy to be getting old, man.
Yeah, the gray hair is badge of honor for you? Not gonna adjust for men?
My grandpa, full-blood Native American, ran the Silver Fox look basically my whole life, mm-hmm. and he looked awesome, dude. He had so much swag. So yeah, I'm ready for it. I'm ready for the whole thing to just go. I'm all for it.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
How's your pops? Is he white hair?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Ah man. Yeah, my dad was solid silver.
Yep. I like it. I don't know. It looks cool.
How old are you right now?
29.
29.
Yes, sir.
You're almost vet class ready.
About there.
Why do you think guys are racing so far now? Like, I mean, before, I remember when like John Dowd was in his 30s, people were making a big deal about it, but guys race well into their 30s now.
I've thought about it a little bit lately. Obviously for myself, getting older, and I don't really feel like I want to slow down. Mm-hmm. And for me, I mean, I've had a lot of injuries, a lot of things that have, you know, a lot of scary moments in my career, but I've joked about it before, but people ask me, when am I gonna hang it up and stop and go do something else? And I'm like, nothing else wakes me up in the morning. I'm like obsessively passionate about this stuff. I love it. It's all I really care about. Mm-hmm. I mean, if I gotta die on the field, so be it. You know what I mean? I'd rather just do this stuff until I can't do it. Mm-hmm. So I just love it that much. And I don't know, I think a lot of guys too, I think these days with the training programs and the nutrition stuff and how we take care of our bodies and all of that, and just having more advice from other people, I think it just makes it easier to keep going because you're still healthy and you're not as burnt out. I think a lot of people are being a little more conscious of that too, and mm-hmm. understanding themselves. You know, the older I get, the more I learn myself and learn what makes me tick, and you know, I need a little of this, a little of that, but this is still the focus and still what I love. So mm-hmm. I think just keeping things fresh and, you know, being around people you want to be around and that make the job enjoyable. Like for myself, I'm training with, you know, Colt, and I'm around Will and Colt all the time, and those are two of my best friends. So it makes it so fun. And I don't know, I think that you also get to that point where when you do retire from any professional sport or a high level of anything in life, there comes that moment of, who am I? What do I do? Mm-hmm. You know, you've been someone in our small bubble, you've been someone since you were a little kid. And it's really hard to make that transition. You know, I think that's a big, big thing that you have to wrestle with when you do retire. If you don't have anything to step right into, that could get a little dangerous sometimes. You know, you can kind of go off the rails, I think. You've seen it in other sports and a lot of things. So I think I can only speak for myself, but putting that off as long as you can, you know, normal job in the real world where none of us are really, our skills aren't exactly conducive to like a very successful career and much else. I think that'll always be there. And if you still love this stuff the way I love this stuff, mm-hmm. staying as long as you can. You know, I mean, I would, you know, you're going to do it for free anyways. You know, when you're done, you're going to spend your money to ride dirt bikes and race. I am. I love it. You know, so I think that's part of it.
See, to hear this come from you is good, right? Because I think there was a time within the past year when you were kind of burnt out or things were not going so well and you were kind of over it.
It's happened. I mean, it happens to everybody, that whole burnout thing. And a lot of that, again, I can only speak for myself, but a lot of that for me, especially last year, that was just lack of competitiveness. Like I wasn't competitive, and that was very frustrating because I was still trying to put in all the work and do all the stuff, and I just couldn't crack the code, you know? And I've been at least my results, if you look at my vault, is insane. Like, it's terrible, terrible, terrible win. Terrible, terrible, terrible top five. Like, it's a weird career that I've had, but I've always known I'm competitive, and I could be, and it, you know, the right things happen, the stars align, I could battle for a win, or at least be up front, where last year I just wasn't. You know, I wasn't even, I had a whole shot, I could maybe lead a couple laps, and then I'd get shuffled back. And that just got really frustrating for me. I think it is for anybody that's competitive like we are and that's been successful at anything. So that was the hardest for me. And the only other time I really felt that was 2020. I had about 5 months off from a head injury. And I really did a lot of soul searching, I guess. I figured out a lot of things about myself. And that's when I really discovered, like, you always know it, but I really understood how much I love this stuff and how much I honestly, I need it. You know, like if you take the sport as a whole away, I'd have a hard time with life because it's what I'm so passionate for, you know? So I think that helped me realize a lot of things and, you know, injuries do that, lack of competitiveness do that, like those things factor in. But ultimately, as soon as you take a step back, a breath and count to 10, when you're the way I am, you realize like, okay, this is just frustration. This isn't, it's not the sport, you know? And anything you're battling in the sport that you could blame on, you know, our industry, yada, yada, like it's everything in life is the same way. So it's just the way things work. Mm-hmm. So you have to just power through it sometimes if that's truly what you love doing, which for me, that was kind of what I realized is I need this stuff. So what am I gonna do? Cry about it and, you know, complain about the one thing that's given me a life and all of my best friends and everything I could imagine? Of course not.
Yeah. Early on, you mentioned injuries, right? Was the worst injury the broken back? Was that like 12? 13?
That was December 3rd, 2013. 13. And I guess, like physically, yes, that was because I was, I mean, I hit a triple without my bike, you know, and I, you know, small fractures to L1, 2, 3, 4, 5, compression fracture T3, broke my scapula in half, my shoulder blade, and I was knocked out for a while. But at that time, I'd been putting in so much work with, at the time it was Geico Honda and my trainer, Ryan Fedoro, and I was ready mentally to go challenge for championships at the time. And I remember hearing that when I woke up, I was just pissed. I wasn't sad. I wasn't any of that. I was upset because I was like, I'm going to miss Supercross now. Like, like get me to the hospital, give me some pain meds so I can deal with this. And I put me together so I can do this. So mentally that one wasn't that hard because I was in good shape and I was so mentally strong at the time. I just wanted to get back to work. You know, and luckily I had a very good influence with Ryan and the few people around me that just were like, we're not going to sit here and cry about it. We're going to get better. And, you know, by the grace of God, I was back for round one barely, but I was. And it kept the dream alive of challenging for that championship, which ultimately fell into my favor. And I ended up winning that, which still the only championship I've got as a professional. So that one taught me a lot just for, you know, not really like diving into self-pity and being, you know, poor me, feeling bad for myself kind of thing. It was like, okay, well, this happened. Like, I can't change it. I just have to do what I can to move forward and get better, whatever that means. If that means Supercross, cool. If it means outdoors, then maybe I'd try to win that one. Like, just move forward. I think the hardest injury I had was the one I had mentioned earlier in 2020 with the concussion I had at Glendale in the first corner, because that one was pretty rough. And that one's the only injury I've ever had that, you know, scared me.
Yeah.
And I took a lot of time off.
Crazy, bones heal. Brain's scary.
Yeah. And even there's people dealing with it right now that obviously I'm close with. And the only advice I can give them is you can tape up anything else. You can, you know, chew on a stick and be tough. But when it comes to the brain, it's a different thing. You know, I saw throughout my career a lot of top level neurologists and doctors and people just trying to learn what I could do to make it better and this and that. But they still don't know that much about the brain, you know? So from my experience, you give it time to heal and then you're fine. You know, if you don't and you just compound those things, it makes it pretty tough. So I just got to a point where that one kind of scared me. But then I took 5 months off. I felt normal again. I started riding again. And I was like, okay, that was just a moment in time that I felt a certain thing that I don't need to be married to that feeling. Mm-hmm. Move on from it and realize that, you know, I could let it scare me and back away from my life and live the rest of my life scared, or I can learn from it, you know, apply what I've learned, move on for the future, and still do what I love to do and accept that there is no highs without lows. There's no good without bad. That's the yin and the yang, right? There's no, you cannot have something as awesome as racing a dirt bike for a living without there being some things that you don't want to deal with that come along with it. That's just life. So yeah. For me, I had that realization and I understood that. And I said, well, again, I'd rather do this and live my life the way I want, doing what I love the most, you know? And if you got to burn bright and burn out quicker, it is what it is, right? I mean, shit, man, what else are you going to do? You only get one time on this little merry-go-round. You might as well enjoy it.
Make the best of it. Hey, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors. We'll be back for more with Justin. Everyone, welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors with Justin Bogle. I met a guy at the track the other day. He was like part of like a veterans motocross team or something. But on the back of his helmet, he had this saying that the team had, and it was "die living." And I was thinking of that when you were talking about what you were just now. I mean, such a good saying, right?
It's how else are you going to do it, you know? And I think one thing that, you know, me and my wife have discussed this a lot because, you know, it's life, but, you know, I could do this whole thing and stop this and stop doing what makes me happy, all that stuff, and be safe and whatever. But ultimately, I mean, what's the point of doing all this, spending my whole life getting here to just walk away from it because I got a little scared of it? You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I think most people aren't fortunate enough, which, again, I don't know how or why this happens, but, you know, I got blessed with my dad didn't race. Like, he rode dirt bikes a little, but not like that. I just got super blessed with being in a position where my dad saw I was really passionate about something, and I found what I loved at a very young age, mm-hmm. as far back as I can remember. My first memories are me on a dirt bike, right? So can't take that for granted, because most people don't get that. A lot of people in life go through their life without really finding whatever it is that they are obsessed with, yeah. you know? So that was a big lesson for me too. It's like, that is a huge blessing. Can't take that for granted. So you be scared and not want to do something because there's bad things to it. There's bad things to everything, man. Everything. Mm-hmm. My wife's the best thing that's ever happened to me, right? But, you know, it's a relationship, it's a marriage, it's hard. But it doesn't change the fact that I would never change that, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Anything good is difficult at times. It's not always, but it is at times, you know? Like, it's all worth it when you win a race, but how many races do most guys win, you know? Not everyone's Eli Tomac, Ricky Carmichael, James Stewart. You know, I won four races, four overalls in my professional career. Mm-hmm. I was a factory rider for a decade almost, you know? It's not that simple. So kind of have to be in love with the rest of it too, which is the work and just loving doing the actual act of whatever you do. So yes, die living, man. I'd rather, like I said, die on the field than just die old, boring, and doing nothing.
Taking a dump, right?
I mean,
hey. That happens to old people. Okay, so it's been almost a decade since your Supercross title. And I think about that Supercross title when I see you, because we shot that cool photo, remember, with the back brace and the trophy. But does it seem like 9 years ago?
It does and doesn't. I think that probably similar answer from anyone you'd ask. Like, yes, because I was, you know, 21 maybe, just turned 21 years old when it happened. And I'm creeping up on 30 now. So yeah, I was in a very different place in my life. Very, very different place. And I've had an entire 450 career since then, you mm-hmm. know? So it does. At the same time, I still feel like I'm 19 years old. You know, I still feel like I'm that same kid. You're not, but yeah, it feels like yesterday, but it feels like a lifetime apart at the same time, which is, I mean, obviously that's an oxymoron, but it's true. I feel like the same kid, but at the same time, I've lived a life since then, you know? Mm-hmm. So I don't know. It's crazy to think about it. Almost a decade, man. Who'd have thunk it, you know?
Yeah. And when we were in the hills last week, we went out riding in the muddy hills. It was so funny for me to see you and Will, the banter, and then throw Colt into the mix and stuff. It's like, you guys are the ones that have always been so tight the whole time. Because I remember I first met Colt at Raynard's place when I came out to film you. And then, you know, you and Will were teammates. And it's just, it's funny to see the people that you're closest with in the sport and then think back decades and the relationships, how they were back then. And the jokes are still the same.
I mean, it's crazy. That's another beautiful thing about it too. This whole life's given me my best friends in mm-hmm. my life, you know? Colt's been my best friend since I was 5 years old, mm-hmm. you know? And Will, obviously, I've always been close with him. We kind of grew up close to each other. And it's funny, no matter where either any of us go or what teams we're on or whatever, those are still my guys, you know? Like, mm-hmm. it's pretty awesome. And it's so cool to be working with both of them and around them all the time, because there's no ego involved. There's ego involved with everyone else. You never want to get beat. With those guys, and even Will, back when we were teammates, we've talked about it recently, even that we never had that, because if we were on equal footing, if I'm on equal footing with somebody, me and Will, we were on the same team, we had the same trainer, we did the same stuff. If he mm-hmm. beat me, I'm going to shake your hand and say, you're the better man today. Like, and then like, we move on and go about life. Mm-hmm. You know, with Colt, it was always that growing up for me. I'm not one of those guys that's got to hate who I'm racing against, you know? But I think I learned that because Colt was my best friend growing up and we battled ridiculously hard every weekend. Mm-hmm. So it's just really cool, man, to be able to push each other and not have that like animosity and ego involved and just be able to get better and be happy for each other.
Yeah.
I tell Colt things about racing and life and whatever that I wouldn't tell anybody, you know, like I'll give Colt every secret in the book because my hope for him is that he has a better 450 career than me. Mm-hmm. You know, I want that for him just as bad as he does. You know, I'm like, dude, I made a lot of these mistakes. You don't have to because I did them for you. You know, my career definitely didn't pan out the way I thought it was going to. You know, I barely won ever. I struggled a lot. I mean, results wise, it was pretty shit. So, but I learned a lot and I tried everything. I trained this way. I raced, you know, this way. I did starts like this. I went to Florida. I went to California. I went to Oklahoma. I tried a bunch of different things. So being able to help him and just be around, even going to some of the races this year and being there with him to help is just, it's nice because I feel like he respects and trusts what I'm saying and knows that I'm not getting paid to do it. I'm just here because you're my brother and I want you to do well, you know, and I believe in him. So that makes it so fun too, being able to kind of, you know, give some of the wisdom that I've gained. I mean, don't get me wrong, I'm no Einstein, but learned a couple things in my day, mostly by making mistakes over and over again, but hey, who's counting?
Okay, are you based in California now, or are you Oklahoma?
I live in Florida, down there by Tampa area, Dade City, mm-hmm. all that, you know? That's where my house is. I have a supercross track down there, and so I'm there sometimes, and then I've been out here staying with Colt. Mm-hmm. And honestly, it's just easier to be in California for me right now, to be able to get a bike, and you know, if I need gear, I can just, you know, call Roger and go over to 7 because it's, you know, just across town. Mm-hmm. Rather than having to coordinate everything, get parts sent, do all that. Like, if I need something, I can get it. Picked up my bike from Pro Circuit, and those guys, Mitch and Schneike and everybody over there, super helpful. So it just makes it easier for right now. And then being able to train with Will, he's got an awesome gym set up in his garage that's perfect. And then just be around Colt and be able to kind of hold each other accountable and push each other, and it just makes it easier. So right now I'm in California and I'm enjoying it.
Nice. One more quick break to hear from our sponsors. Back for more. Everyone, welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Okay, so you kind of alluded to the fact that you're picking up gear at 7, building a bike. Mitch is giving you a bike. So Walton Kawasaki of Canada, you're yep. headed to the Great White North pretty soon then, right? Doesn't it start in a couple months? Or
Yep, I think round one's June 3rd. Okay. I'm excited, man. The Walton 7 Kawasaki team, it's kind of a random how it happened. Chad from the team had just hit me up on Instagram. Mm-hmm. And I was like, honestly, I don't have a lot going on besides World Supercross. And if it could work, you know, logistically and with schedules, then I'd be interested in doing it. I've kind of always had the thought of I wanted to go race there and try it. Mm-hmm. Like I'm friends with some people that are from there and that race there. And it just seems like a really fun environment. Good competition. I think people underestimate the competition there. Those guys are fast. So I'm just excited, man. It gives me, you know, something to go after, a goal. Mm-hmm. And with that in World Supercross and a few other things that may come up, it gives me, who knows, maybe the most interesting, fun summer of my career. So I'm really excited about it, though. Like I said, I've always wanted to go back and ride a Kawasaki and go to Canada and try that out and kind of give me the best of both worlds. I get to go race there, ride outdoors, which I love doing, mm-hmm. and then race World Supercross, which was a fun experience last year, and I'm excited about that as well. So I'm pumped, man. I'm stoked that they're giving me the opportunity. 250 for both series as of right now, which I originally, the deal was for 450 up there, and it got changed last minute. And I had to think about it because I was like, well, I feel like, you know, I wanted to ride a 450 if I was going up there for outdoors, but it wasn't going to happen. And I had to think about it for a bit, and I was like, well, again, something different and exciting. Let's give it a shot and try it and see how it goes. So I really enjoy riding 250s as well. So, I mean, we'll see. It'll be fun.
Yeah. Do you think your riding style is better for a 250? Or
I mean,
you're not a big guy.
So no, I'm not. And I've always just been skinny as hell, dude. So can't put weight on if I tried. So although I was getting a little thick here, and I had off season, man, and I was, you know, I was like, man, this retired kind of life, it's not for me, you know. Wife was coming up and grabbing my handles here and there, and my love handles, I'm like, hey, chill out. So yeah, I don't know, for Supercross especially, I really enjoy the 250. I think for myself, I think it just, the 250 fits the stadiums better, and mm-hmm. I ride a 250 in Supercross better. And outdoors, I don't really know, it's been a long time since I've raced one outdoors. So
have you gotten on a KX250 yet?
Not yet.
Because you're on a 450 the other day.
Yeah.
Is Mitch helping the team?
Yep.
Okay, so Pro Circuit Kawasaki 250, come on.
Doesn't get much better than that.
Yeah.
Last time I rode one of those was at Loretta's in the B class. And I was really good on them back then. So hopefully they're kind of the similar thing when I get back on it now. But we'll see. You never know, man. At that point, I haven't ridden Kawasaki since I was, 17? Mm-hmm. But I raced Kawasaki's my whole life from the time I was on a 65 until I signed with the Geico team and went pro. So it does feel a bit like feel like home a bit, you know. Mm-hmm. There's something, I don't know, seeing the 891 on a Kawasaki motorcycle just looks cool, man. I don't know.
Are you bringing back the orange helmet?
I need to, honestly. You know, wearing Bell helmets, which I'm pumped about because I love the Bell helmet. It fits great. Super awesome looking helmet too. Safe, all that, which is important to me at this stage of my career, in my life. I'd rather wear the best helmets that I can, right? So I just got the black carbon fiber one right now, but I ordered me one of the Showtime ones. I was like the green.
Oh, that one back there.
It looks so good. So I'm excited about that. And I don't know, man, you never know. If I could make it work and give me a one-off orange one for a round or something, that'd be pretty cool. I think my dad would be stoked, if anybody.
Yeah. All right. Not to turn the tone of the show down, but I mean, we can't have this show, you and I, without addressing Ryan. Mm. Like, dude, when I heard that Fed had passed, I mean, it was like getting punched in the gut, you know? And I was like 1 millionth as close to him as you were. For me, like, Fed was the nicest guy, the most encouraging guy. Because, you know, when I started my whole mountain bike thing, like, dude, I was so embarrassed, right? Because, like, I started in cross country, so I had to wear Lycra. It's like, fat dude in Lycra is, like, super embarrassing. But, dude, Fed was so encouraging for me. And so, you know, he's like, you have a Strava? I'm like, no. Yeah, you do. And he's like, grabbed my phone and looked it up and followed me instantly. And he thumbed up everything I did and always checked in with me, you know, but such an awesome guy. And I know he was your best friend, your trainer and everything, but thoughts on losing that guy?
I mean, it's been rough, obviously. I think I'd never really, I mean, I've had, you know, lost grandparents, things like that, but they're older and you're kind of ready for it.
Yeah.
With Ryan, it was obviously different because, I mean, he left the house that night. I was staying with him, mm-hmm. you know, he left the house that night. And then me and my wife now, it's getting late. We didn't know what was going on. So then we're driving around trying to find him, different hospitals and whatever. And then, you know, I had to call his mom and figure all that out and be there and try to sort things and help, you know, move his stuff to storage. And, you know, one of the hardest things I've ever had to do was speaking at his funeral. That was tough. And God bless him. But Chappie being there was the saving grace for all of us, obviously. Mm-hmm. Chappie is the man, and he's such a good human being, and he really helped keep, you know, me and Will on track through it, and mm-hmm. you know, kind of coached me through how to deal with it, and I think that was big. And then I don't know, it's tough losing somebody that you obviously that you love, and that you like. For me, Ryan was a mentor, one of my best friends, but he's also like a father figure for me. Mm-hmm. You know, like anything that was going on in my life, I would call him for advice or whatever, you know, and I knew he cared about me enough and loved me as well to give me the best advice he could. Mm-hmm. And honestly, man, he kind of picked up like where my dad left off. I moved out here to California when I was 18 and I was pretty green. I'd never really been a lot of places. I didn't know a lot. And Ryan really kind of taught me also how to be a man too, you know, and to be strong and to overcome a lot of things. Like we went through a lot together in my career, you know, and I mean, the funniest part about it is when I started working with him, going into my second year pro, I was 100% sure he hated me, dude, because he was on my ass constantly. He was really hard on me, dude, but it was what I needed. It was really good for me. Same way that my dad was maybe kind of tough on me growing up, never like yelling or, you know, doing anything crazy, but just expected a lot out of me because he could see the potential. It's kind of the same thing, and there's teaching me responsibility and how to be a man, you know. Mm-hmm. And later on in our lives, when we stopped working together professionally, we almost got closer, you know, because then we didn't have the work side of things where you had to separate it. It was just, you know, friendship.
Yeah.
Like real friendship, which you don't get a lot. You know, I have a couple of those in my life that you can count on, and that's about it. God doesn't bless you with a lot of that. You have to be a good friend to have good friends, and you only get a few of them, you know? So Ryan was that for me. And I think also looking back to last year and what I was dealing with professionally with my job and struggling with competing. And then, I mean, obviously everyone knew about it, but that was also going on between races, and I'm, you know, having to deal with that and process that, which I'd never had to process before or learn how to deal with that in my life. So that was tough. And, you know, saving grace in it was my friends and my wife and people to be there for you, you know, in that moment, which you need more than you even realize. And yeah, man, I mean, obviously miss him like we all do, but mm-hmm. without him, who knows where or how my life and career would have went.
Yeah.
You know, because I made a lot of mistakes still, even with the guidance that I had. So definitely kept me from being soft and just never giving up, you know? And I think that was one thing that I could always hang my hat on with my career is that I wasn't a quitter and I was tough. I rode through injuries my whole career. So a lot of that I would attribute to him, you know, just teaching me those things. And, you know, even not professionally, just as a human, he's just one of the best, you know. Mm-hmm. Anyone that you talk to about him, you'd be hard pressed to find somebody that would tell you different.
Yeah.
You know, like with you, he didn't have to do that for you, but he did because mm-hmm. he was just a good guy, you know, and he cared about people that if you were in with him, you were in with him, you know. And there was a lot of similarities between us. I think we similar personalities, you know, maybe a little rough around the edges, but heavily love what you love and who you love. And yeah, I think that's why we kind of got on so well and kind of took me under his wing like his little kid brother or his son almost, you know?
Did he ever, he and I joked about getting you that avocado slicer. Did he
ever? Yeah, holy guacamole, right?
Yeah.
That was an embarrassing moment in my career. I was making lunch before press day at Glen Helen, my rookie 450 year, and I went to get the seed out of the avocado. I twisted it, and I put the knife right into my hand, like a pretty solid, a good cut. And he wasn't happy about that one, but nobody was, trust me. And I tried to act like it was fine. I tried to hide it, and then...
Did you super glued it shut, right?
I did all kinds of stuff. And I pulled off after the first moto, and my hand was just dripping blood, and it's Glen Helen, dude.
Yeah.
450 moto. I couldn't hang on. It was sketchy. So that one was tough. That one took a minute to heal up. I still got the scar, but embarrassing, man. And then the next week, my Chance Seeley was the gear guy at the time for me. Brings me gear with the butt patch on it. This is holy guacamole. And I was like, dude, I'm the last guy to ever be too serious, but too soon, all right? I am on thin ice already, dude. I'm in the factory Honda rig, and these guys are already not pumped on me. Too soon, okay? Let's just give it another week or two, and then this is funny. But right now, it's not that funny. So in hindsight, it's a funny story, but again, was embarrassing.
Yeah. We're almost out of time, but last question. What's going on with music?
Music is my second love, you know what I mean? I'm a hobbyist. I'm delusionally confident with a lot of things in life, right? But I'm not crazy enough to think that I'm gonna be, you know, professional at making music, mm-hmm. you know? But I love it, and I make music all the time. It's how I vent, it's what I do, I enjoy it, I love the process of it, I love, you know, recording myself, engineering my own voice, I love that, you know, mm-hmm. it's really fun for me. So yeah, I put stuff out here and there whenever I feel like it and just use it for that, and it's, everyone needs something, right? Like a lot of guys, golf or whatever, I've never been interested in certain, those other things really, but I love music, I always have. So that's what I do for fun, and I really, really enjoy it. Whenever Ryan passed, that was a big thing for me. I didn't sleep for a few days. You know, I made, on my last album that I put out, Trust Me, Everything's Fine, I made Legends Never Die the night before his funeral, and then I made Time Heals the night after. And I needed that to like stay sane and to process the emotion and deal with it, because I'm not really that good at talking about it, you know? Like, I don't go to therapy, but I probably should, you know? I think a lot of us should, but that's my therapy, you know? I really do need it. So yeah, I've got a project right now that I'm just waiting to get back from Phrase, get it mixed up, and I'll put it out. But it's just for fun, man. It's like people, when I was younger, would have their opinions on it, but I just don't care, you know? Mm-hmm. One thing about how I look at life and how I operate, I'm pretty damn secure in myself. It is what it is. Like, I know who I am. I know what I'm doing. Like, I don't really need outside validation. I'm fine with it, dude. I don't do anything that I feel like is wrong. I don't push the limit with things, with the music stuff, but I need the music stuff, you know? Mm-hmm. And I love it. What are you gonna do? The heart wants what it wants, baby. I love making music, so.
Right on. Well, hey, man, thanks for coming on. And best of luck in Canada this summer and World Supercross this winter.
Thank you, sir.
All right, buddy. Guys, thanks for watching, and we'll see you next week.